Sri Lanka is again on the verge of a historical shift. And how did this come about? As we all know, 10 years ago, the civil war ended. The government in power at the end of the war continued to consolidate power throughout the country. And then there was an upsurge and a change. And in 2015, there was regime change. And with that regime change, some things remained the same and some things changed drastically. Definitely, as far as the North and East, there was a huge opening of political space, protests, rights struggles, and broadly an opening of democratic space. But in terms of our economic policies, I would argue that since the end of the war in 2009, we have continued with neoliberal economic policies. That is what the Rajapaksa government did from 2009 to 2014, and that is what the Sirisena Vikramasinghe government also did in terms of economic governance of the country. There was continued financialization, there was importance given to the private sector with very few benefits to the people. This was the context in which, amidst a deteriorating economy, that in 2018 the SLPP as a new political party was born and swept the local government elections, particularly in the south of the country. That was a warning signal of the great disenchantment in the rural areas, the impact of the long drought, the lack of concern given by the Sirisena Vikramasinghe government to the rural constituencies. Their efforts to remedy that were very partial. In terms of the rural economy, the Sirisena Vikramasinghe government, or factions of them, had three big platforms. Under President Sirisena, there was the Grama Shakti or village development program, and under Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe, there was the Gamperidia program and Enterprise Sri Lanka. In my view, all three of those so-called economic development initiatives, the big banner initiatives, were flawed and eventually failed. In the meantime, there was also the Easter attacks. Despite security warnings and not heeded by the government, leading to a massive catastrophe and even a backlash against the Muslim community. This was the context of the elections of 2019, and again our electorate had very diverging voting patterns. In the north, an overwhelming majority of the Tamil population voted for Sajith Premadasa. An overwhelming majority of the Muslim community that had been facing the backlash also voted for Sajith Premadasa. But in the south, it was the opposite. A significant majority voted for Gotabaya Rajapaksa, with him winning more or less a landslide victory, particularly in the southern constituencies, and being elected president. So there have been a number of factors that led to it. Definitely economic factors, as they have developed over the last 5 years, were important. The way in which ethno-religious politics has played into this, in terms of the Easter attacks and its fallout, have been significant. In terms of the northern voters, it is significant to say that they voted overwhelmingly for a singular Buddhist candidate in the form of Sajith Premadasa. My analysis of the northern or minority voting is that there was overwhelming engagement People wanted to use the democratic space which had been denied for them for 30 years during the war and was only developing over the last 10 years. So the Northern vote I see as an initiative towards using the democratic space that is available. Similarly, in the South, I don't think it can be reduced merely to majoritarian or Sinhala Buddhist nationalist politics. Economic factors have played, an anti-incumbency vote has also been important. Nevertheless, now we have a government that is consolidating power. What does this mean for human rights work or broader democratic rights in this country is the big question facing us. As I mentioned, even in the war-torn regions of the North, there was considerable democratic space that opened up after 2015. Before 2014, people were even afraid to speak in private about political concerns. After 2015, there have been protests out on the streets. Will this space continue after regime change in 2019 is an important question and a challenge facing all the citizens of Sri Lanka. How is that democratic space going to be preserved? Because when you're thinking of human rights, we also have to think about the freedom of expression, freedom of association, and democratic political rights more broadly. They are all intertwined. And it is the level of democratic space that will allow room for also human rights work, not just in terms of abuses by the state, but even other forms of rights violations, whether it's child rights violations or women's rights violations. These are all interrelated to democratic space. And this is where the last 3 weeks since regime change, there are some worries. What does the proroguing of the parliament for a whole month mean when we also see the government moving very fast on many policies, including on economic policies such as the changes to taxation that they have brought about? Does this prorogation of the parliament mean that our concerns will not be raised by parliamentarians for a month? And when the prorogation ends in a month's time, will they prorogue it again until dissolving parliament? So in the immediate term, when you're talking about democratic space, the space within parliament is important, or the engagement of our parliamentarians is important. What will happen in terms of media freedoms? Because the right to freedom of expression is very much related to media freedom. Will the media allow room for dissent, for critical views? Will there be censorship by our journalists and our columnists? That's an important question. Because without that kind of democratic space and freedom of expression, people will not work together, freedom of association might be curtailed. Will our institutions continue to work, our social institutions, our social movements, continue to have activities that bring people together? Because that is crucial for the individual rights that human rights seeks to protect. Looking forward then, what the big question before us is, what is Sri Lankan democracy going to look like over the next 5 years of the term of the new president? There are two important questions that are going to be determined by the strength of parliament. What happens in the parliamentary elections, whether after the parliamentary elections there will be a strong opposition, or would the president and the government in power be able to consolidate and centralize power, is the crucial question before us. And there are two amendments to our constitution are fundamental. The 19th amendment, which reduced the powers of the executive. What would happen to the future of the 19th amendment? President Rajapaksa has very clearly and openly stated that with two-thirds majority, they intend to repeal the 19th Amendment. That would be a huge blow to democracy in this country. I also have another worry: what would happen to the 13th Amendment and the provincial council system? Already, the new president and government have said that they will go according to the wishes of the majority. In other words, we are looking at a majoritarian democracy at the center. Would there be enough autonomy, at least at the provincial level, for people to determine some aspects of their socio-economic and political life? The president has said that development is the way to move forward, but without devolution, there won't be participatory development. So over the next 5 years, the important question for us to grapple with is how to reduce the centralization of executive power. For now, decades we have debated the need for abolition of the executive presidency. The 19th Amendment was a partial step in that direction. Are we going to continue in that direction, or are we going to reverse it again and give excessive powers to the executive? And what would be the role of the parliament? Will the parliament just merely become a rubber stamp for the executive with a consolidation of power and a two-thirds majority? Or will the parliament continue to debate and legislate on the concerns of the people in a democratic manner? And what will happen to freedoms on the ground? Human rights, as I mentioned, is very much intertwined with our democratic rights, with our democratic freedoms. And what would be the sense that people have about that democratic space, about their own rights? How are we going to ensure that? These are the challenges before society and social movements more generally. Thank you.